Hello everybody. Thank you so much for the invitation. Can you hear me? Yes? Okay. So my name is Vasia Kalavri, or Vasiliki. I'm a postdoc at ETH Zürich, and I work on distributed data flow systems and large-scale graph analysis. And so today I have prepared a presentation about two papers, projects that we have recently worked on in the general area of streaming data flow systems, but more specifically, these are two pieces of a puzzle that will make streaming systems reconfigurable and self-managed. And so I have a lot of material and I could cover all of it, but I think it's better if you get something out of it and I don't have to speak like for an hour. So I will go slowly, and if you have any questions, you can interrupt me. And if I don't manage to cover everything, that's fine, because you can, if you're interested, you can read the rest in the papers, okay? Okay, so I will start by giving an overview and a general framework for you to understand what I mean by data flow systems. Is how many of you are familiar with Spark, Flink, TensorFlow? Yes, you are, more or less? Okay, you've heard some of these words before. Okay, good. Okay, so the systems I'm talking about, and what I mean when I say streaming data flow systems, are systems like Spark, Heron, and Flink, and in some cases also systems like TensorFlow, because they have a lot of similarities. And they have the following properties. So computations can be represented as directed acyclic graphs, and where in these graphs the operators are the nodes and the edges are data channels, right? So you have a data flow graph that represents the computation that you want to perform, and then comparators could accumulate state. They could have multiple inputs, and they can be arbitrary complex. So you can have UDFs in the operators, or you can have very simple operators like map, filter, and these kind of things. And you can also have window-based operators. So something like every 5 minutes make this computation, or every 5 minutes and slide the window over the records by 1 minute, and then give me an updated version of the result that I'm trying to compute. And you can have also arbitrarily custom window-based logic, so you can also build your own windows. In general, we assume that transformations are data parallel. So this is a data parallel distribution model where you have a lot of data and you have a cluster of machines. And the way you parallelize the computation is just by partitioning the data across the nodes, and then all of the nodes more or less do the same computation. So part of the data flow. There are different ways to do the mappings, but in general, I assume data parallel operators. And queries are long running, so that's a difference, for example, as opposed to MapReduce jobs, right? So queries are not ad hoc. You don't send them once and then you wait for the result. You take the result and it finishes. These are long-standing queries that could run for days or months or years, possibly. And you assume that your data is an unbounded stream, possibly unbounded stream, and you continuously receive data at the sources of the data flow and continuously produce data at the sinks of the data flow. Okay? So far clear? Okay. So this looks like that. This is a very simple example. Let's say you have a stream of tweets that go into a Twitter source in your data flow, and then you have an operator that extracts hashtags from these tweets, and this sends the data then to a count topics operator that counts per hashtag how many tweets have been there, and then you have a sync that outputs the result, which in this case is a list of trends, let's say. Okay, so this would be the business logic of your application, or the logical data flow in this case. This is usually translated to something like the following. This is the physical data flow, or the query plan, where a source could be actually distributed, so you might be receiving these tweets from different sources. The extract hashtags could be a map operation or a flat map operation. The count topics would be a reduced top k operation. So here you see you have a shuffle by a hashtag, which in this case is the key. And then the sync could be anything from your standard output to some other system like a database or some monitoring system. That's up to you. So in general, these could be scheduled on different workers. So in this case, for example, you could have the source and the map running on each worker, the two parallel instances. You could have the top k distributed over four workers, and you could have the syncs again in another two workers. And these could be assigned on different machines in some other way. Okay, so there are systems who do it this way, there are systems who do it in another way, but in general, this assignment varies among systems. Okay? Okay. Now, we assume that workers make the following series of activities. They can receive messages from other workers. They can deserialize data. They process data, they serialize data, and they send messages. So in general, you could represent the execution of a streaming data flow as a time-evolving graph of parallel workers, where every line here is a timeline of a worker, and then the edges are these activities or the messages that they receive. Okay. Now, when workers are not busy and they don't have something to do, they can also be waiting. Right, and there are two cases that data flow workers might be waiting. One is because they have nothing in their input buffer, so there's no data for them to process, or there is no available buffer for them to output a result. So they have processed something, they need to serialize it into a buffer, but there's no buffer available, probably because some other worker later in the data flow is overloaded. Okay? So that's a general model framework when I talk about data flow systems, okay? Now, the project I'm working on in Zurich has the goal of building a data flow system, a streaming data flow system like that, that would be used for monitoring and analyzing data centers. So the idea of the project is that you have a data center that produces all kinds of events, all kinds of streams in reality. And this could be logs, traces, configuration updates, topology updates, whatever you can monitor in your data center is in fact a stream, right? Something, some information that gets continuously produced. And the idea of the project is to have a streaming data flow system on the other side that ingests all of these streams in real time and builds the data center state inside the stream processor. So instead of having to run diagnostics in the data center itself, you can query the state in the stream processor, and you could possibly even do what-if analysis or simulations. So that's a use case. If you want to learn more about this and what applications we have already built on top of that, you can go to streamonsystems.eth.ch. I myself don't work on the application side of this project, so I know a little bit about what these streams could be or what analytics you could run on them, but I'm working on creating that system itself, and that's what my talk will be about. So one requirement that this data center monitoring streaming system would have, is that it has to be reconfigurable. And by that, I mean two things. I mean that it should react to changes in the workload. So you might have here the rates of the event streams or the volumes of the volume of the event streams changing over time, and the stream processor should be able to keep up with whatever is in the input, and also not over-provision if the rates drop. And the second is it should be able to profile the execution of streaming computations and identify bottlenecks. So these are the two parts I'm going to talk about. So the Snail Trail Profiler is an NSDI paper, 2018, and the Autoscaling Controller is OSDI 18. And I will start with Snail Trail, and then if we have time, continue with DS2. Okay, but the vision is that in the end you would have a streaming application, any kind of streaming application, that outputs profiling information into the module of performance analysis, and then the performance analysis module identifies the bottlenecks and identifies what the system needs to do to be automatically be able to catch up with the inputs and meet the SLOs that you have. Okay. So so Snail Trail. So I assume some of you at least are familiar with critical path analysis. Yes, I see some nods. Okay, good. So I think you might find this interesting. So when we started thinking about how to understand performance of streaming computations and how to identify bottlenecks, we first looked at what the current profilers provide, what kind of metrics. And we saw that most of the metrics you get are really aggregates. So you can see your data flow, what is the computation you have written, so you know which operator receives data from which others. You have aggregate durations about several things that happen during the computation, like how much time each task is running. You have some aggregate data exchange, like how many bytes a particular worker instance has sent to some other worker instance, and so on. But these profiling tools don't provide any kind of incentive on what are the critical activities or what are the critical workers that actually delay the computation or affect latency. So, going back to that model of the program activity graph I told you before, if we model the data flow as a graph of activities, messages, and waiting, and to motivate the use of critical path analysis for those of you who don't know, if you just go and take the aggregate duration, like what current profilers do, and you try to optimize, in this case, the processing, which is the most time-consuming activity, well, and say you do some magic there and you actually shorten this activity, the only thing you manage to do is to increase the waiting, right? Because the problem is not that processing takes too long. The problem here actually is that this waiting activity depends on when this message will arrive, and that means that if you shorten if you don't shorten something here, but something here, you have no benefit, right? Because you will just be waiting for this message for longer. Okay, so we wanted to somehow apply the critical path analysis to streaming computations and see whether we can solve this problem. Okay, just some basics on CPA. So in the program activity graph, the nodes are timestamp events. So we get we instrument the system and we get timestamps on when every activity on each worker starts and when it finishes. And the edges, a node can be like this, a timestamp on worker 2, And the edges have the activity type. So if it's processing, serialization, deserialization, and so on. And they have the duration, how long it takes. Right? So the critical path, the definition is that it's the longest path in the execution history. Right? So if you have this graph from the beginning of your execution until the very end, if you backtrack the execution history from the very last event to the beginning, bypassing all the waiting edges, then you get the critical path. So in this case, it could be this one. Of course, it could also be that one or that one, right? So there might be more than one critical path. But once you get this, you have at least some indication of what is taking up what is causing delays in your system. So you have some indication of why this waiting here is happening, right? And you know all the dependencies for that. So if you try to optimize that, you probably minimize the waiting, right? So that's exactly the technique we want to apply on long-running streaming computations. So if you have, as I said, if you have the whole trace, and if you have an application that finishes, then let's say it's kind of easy, right? You have the trace, you create this graph, you backtrack, you find the critical activities, and then you try to optimize them, right? And you can do this offline, and then you rewrite your application, and then you run it again, and you have improved performance. But let's see now how we could do this in an online setting. So what we want to achieve here is if we have a streaming computation that has continuous streams coming and outputs, and it's a long-running one, we want to take a periodic snapshot of this program activity graph, and we want to analyze it in a window by window base, in a snapshot by snapshot base, and then get a stream of performance summaries, right, instead of one performance summary. Because this is a computation that runs continuously, so we cannot wait until the computation finishes, because first of all, it might not finish, and second, the information we might get when it finishes might not be useful at all, right? So we want this to happen in real time while the computation is running. Okay, so we slice the execution traces in snapshots, in windows, of some configurable size, and then we get this execution graph like before. And we have some problems here. So if you try to apply critical path analysis to these snapshots, you run into some challenges. First of all, exactly because you sliced the snapshot yourself, all the paths inside the snapshot have the same length. So all of them are critical paths in this snapshot, right? So this one or this one. So you could think, okay, if all of them are equally critical inside the snapshot, why don't we just choose a random one? Well, of course, choosing a random one might miss some critical activity, so if we take this one, you know, we miss that waiting edge. You could also think of enumerating all the paths. So if all of them are critical, let's just enumerate them and then aggregate them somehow, right? And then find which of them is the most critical. But we found that depending on the system and depending on how dense your instrumentation is, you could have billions or trillions of paths in just one second snapshots, right? Because this grows with the number of parallel workers, and it grows with how fast the system processes records. So it's not really practical to enumerate the paths either. So what can we do? What we really want to do is not find one critical path, right? Because there is no one critical path because the computation hasn't finished. What we really want to do is rate or rank activities with regard to how critical they are at this moment in the computation. So if we assume this is part of an evolving critical path that will form at some point, how can we rank the activities with regard to their criticality or their probability of actually being part of the final critical path? And the intuition here is very simple, actually. So if you think that the more paths an activity appears on, the more critical it might be, because then it's higher probability it's actually part of a critical path. Now, the interesting thing is, how do you compute this thing? Because if you take this small snapshot and you enumerate all the paths, like I said before, even in this very small snapshot, you have 9. And then you could just count all of them and then say, okay, the most critical path is, sorry, the most critical activity is UV, because it's actually part of all the critical paths that exist in this snapshot, right? So we want exactly this result, but without having to materialize all the paths. And we do this by proposing a new metric. And this is basically just a modified version of betweenness centrality. Are you familiar with betweenness centrality? No? Okay, so if you have a graph with edges and nodes, the central nodes or the central edges are the ones that are part of a lot of shortest paths. So if you think in a social network, a person that connects many people is the central node in the social network, or an edge that connects, that many shortest paths go through that edge, is the central edge. Okay, this is really a high level definition, but that's the intuition behind it, right? So we use the same intuition here. We want to find the centrality of the activities in the program activity graph, so we can rank them with regards to criticality, right? So we want to find, basically, the problem is we have really many critical paths, right? And they never end, and we don't know how or where they will end. And we want to find which edges are the most central in this evolving critical path, right? So if you think, the centrality really gives us the probability that an edge actually belongs to that critical path. Well, not exactly, but that's the intuition, right? And then we normalize by the total number of paths in the snapshot, and we also multiply by the activity duration, because longer edges should have a higher weight of criticality. Now, the cool part about this, and you might be wondering, because I just told you it's impractical to enumerate all the paths, how can we do this? And now I'm telling you, oh yeah, let's count in how many paths an activity appears on. The cool part about this is that it can be computed without path enumeration. You actually can do a traversal from left to right, similar to BFS, and then a traversal from right to left, and aggregate the results, and then you get this number. So it's actually really efficient computation to do this. Okay, do you have questions so far? No? Does that mean you haven't understood anything, or yeah? I hope that's not the case. So
are you computing the shortest paths every time in order to find the betweenness centrality?
No, because that's the thing. Yeah, all the paths have the same length. Actually, because we get a snapshot.
Okay.
So all the paths are shortest, all the paths are critical. That's the problem, right? Because we create the snapshot ourselves. So that's the. You could think many variations of this, right? This is just one solution to the problem. You could think of getting a sliding window snapshot. You could think of getting an evolving snapshot. You could think of a different metric. Right? This is just one way, and I don't really have any comparison to alternatives, but I have a master's student working on it, so maybe next year I'll let you know. Okay, but let's see actually how this works a little bit in practice, or at least what kind of information you can get out of this, right? So the cool part about this data flow model, the general data flow model I showed you with the activities and the messages, is that it actually models very well a variety of systems. And we applied the same instrumentation and the same model to Flink, Spark, TensorFlow, Heron, and Timely Data Flow with minor changes, because I mean, some of these systems block on inputs or outputs. Some of these systems just spin continuously until they get input. So we had to make some variations. But the high-level model, the types of activities, and the sequence of performing these activities is the same. So this works for all of these systems. So we have them instrumented to produce this kind of traces. And then these trace streams are fed into another, into a timely data flow instance. So this is this is a bit recursive, right? Because the reference application can be timely, and SnailTrail itself is also timely. So you have a stream processor monitoring another stream processor and trying to find bottlenecks in the other one. So I think it's quite interesting. But you ingest these traces, you construct this graph, and then you compute this ranking, and you create a stream of performance summaries. And these summaries are currently of four types. So you might be interested in different types of bottlenecks, right? And I think the obvious one is which activity type is a bottleneck. So I told you it's processing, serialization, deserialization, and messages. Sorry. So you can rank the activities and then group them by activity type. So you can find basically, yeah, which type of activity is the critical one in your computation. And this looks like this. So that's Flink. Yeah, you get different colors, and then on the y-axis is this CP metric, which you could translate as criticality. And then, so if you see something like this, it's not, it doesn't guarantee anything for you, but it kind of points you to some possible problem. And in this case, it's serialization is very critical, and it shouldn't be more critical than processing, so maybe try a different serializer or something, okay? The second type of summary you could have is if you want to find which worker is actually critical, if a worker is a straggler. And this you can do by, again, ranking the activities and then grouping by workers. And you get something like this, where this is, again, criticality and the different workers. And in this case, what this summary means is that worker one is much more critical than the others, and that means that the worker one's activities are on the critical path all the time, right? This is what this tells you, or this evolving critical path all the time, right? Which in this case might mean that, okay, you need to steal some work from W1. You can also group by operator, right? Like I said before, you have maps, filters, counts, and so on, in which case you get something like this, and here it's just a word count with the flat map and a count. And you ideally want your operators to be equally critical, so no operator is a bottleneck. And in this case, flatmap is a bottleneck, so you might consider increasing its parallelism, so adding more workers for the flatmap operator. And the final summary you can get is a communication summary, in which case you get something like this, a heat map of pairs of workers' communication. Of course, not all of them communicate with all of them, so if you have a better idea of how to visualize this thing, let me know, because this is terrible, I think. But yeah, in this case, you can see, for example, that worker 5 and workers 2, 9, 10, and 11, their messages are all the time on the critical path, right? So you might want to collocate them, right? So these are types of reconfiguration things you could automatically do, right, in a stream processor as a module, and also has the mechanisms for doing these things automatically. Okay? So the code for SnailTrail is online on GitHub. And we're also planning to... So a colleague of mine is currently in UC Berkeley, and he's going to try to put SnailTrail for Ray, a reinforcement learning system. So, yeah, I hope that works out. So, do you have any questions so far? Other questions? No? Okay. Ideas, comments? No? Then, what is that?
One of the things you told me is that you're looking for log files that have stream data and events related to them.
Uh-huh.
What type of thing are you looking for exactly? What do you need? You mentioned timestamps already?
Yeah, so not for this project, but for the data center modeling project in general. There are a couple of applications that my colleagues tried to do, and the problem was that they didn't have ground truth. So they wanted to get streams, log streams of application layer and network layer, and then try out different routing algorithms or load balancing techniques or networking algorithms, and then see how this affects the application layer. Right, so we could do some simulations like this with limited data set that we have, but we haven't found any like further data sets. Right? So that's the thing I was talking to you about. So one of the use cases of StreamOn would be, for example, to we have a demo of this, to change the routing in the network, or to simulate failures of switches or bandwidth different bandwidth constraints, and then see how the traffic matrix changes, for example, but before applying this change to the data center, right? You see it in software. Yeah, so, yes?
So, the logs of the jobs in the system would be enough?
Sorry?
The logs of the system would be enough.
What system?
I mean, like, on supercomputer systems, if I give you the logs of the jobs, it would be enough.
I don't know, what are you gathering? What kinds of logs? If you're gathering everything, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'll contact you.
Okay.
Okay, you. All right. And do I have time to continue or not? Yes? Okay. I can shortly tell you about the second one.
So if you're going to change subjects, can I ask more questions?
Of course.
So one thing that you don't understand is why just not measuring each worker, what each step is doing, like how much you spend time on doing processing, how much you do the weight.
Okay, that question means I totally failed my motivation.
No, just why not be measuring the weight only, instead of be measuring every single process?
Right, so that's exactly what I tried to show in the beginning, and I'll work on that next time. So if you just measure aggregate duration of activities, you miss the dependencies between workers, right? So I had this...
I got it.
You did?
Yeah.
Okay, so if you try to optimize something that just takes long time, you might just end up increasing weighting because you don't know, okay?
Yeah, I got it.
Good.
Okay, another final question. So I assume that the log, as far as I can understand, you parse the log from Spark, right?
Yes.
So you assume a specific log format.
Yes.
Could this be generalized so that perhaps we could feed your tool in a way that could use different logs and identify like this connectivity and
yes, possible? So I think the only restrictions we have are to give us a log of worker ID. So every node is a worker ID and a timestamp, and it's either a start or an end event. And every edge has an activity type, start and end.
And these are all configurable, the activity type, you just need to feed to you in the format.
Yes, so actually we define the general format, and then we customized it a little bit for each system, because not all systems, so we tried it on five different systems, right? And we had to customize a little bit for Flink, a little bit for Spark differently, a little bit for Timely, but for TensorFlow, again, it was different. So we have like a pre-processing module in between that takes the raw logs from Spark or from TensorFlow, translates them to our system, format, and then injects them. But there are a few things you have to take care of there, because there are some assumptions in the model, and some systems may not do the thing you're expecting them to do. For example, some systems in their instrumentation don't have explicit waiting activities, and you have to somehow implicitly deduce that this worker was waiting for this time, or they might seem busy just spinning, and then you have to figure out whether it was doing something useful or not, right? And that really depended on the system. But it's possible. Okay? Any other question on this part? No? Okay, second part. So, actually, this is a good example to make a bridge to the second one. So, you get four types of summaries. You get critical activities, critical workers, critical operators. And the one thing we wanted to try after this project was use the critical path analysis or this performance analysis to do automatic scaling of computations. And I'll actually tell you how this worked out. That's the second part. So, I think this is a general truth. Any streaming job that is long running, no matter how you configure it initially, will inevitably become over or under provisioned in the future, right? Because either your workload will change, so you will at some point receive more events than you can handle, let's say even in Twitter something gets popular, everybody starts tweeting or so on. Or you might have a decreased load, in which case you have provisioned for more than you need and you lose money. Or actually streaming computations, exactly because they are stateful and they accumulate state over time, the performance of your system might degrade over time even if the workload, the outside workload, doesn't change. And then you will have to, you will violate your SLO. So, what do you do? You ideally want a streaming system that is capable of automatic scaling. What that means is that given the logical data flow, so this is like your computation, you want to find the physical data flow, and you want to find how many parallel instances to provision for every operator, so that you want to find the minimum parallelism per operator, so that you can keep up with the sources at all times. Okay, so that's the problem I'm trying to solve. And in general, this is a quite fundamental problem, and many, many people have looked into it, also in different contexts, in the cloud, and so on. So you, generally, the overview is that you have a streaming computation that is running, and you you get some metrics periodically out of it, let's say like in the case of SnailTrail before, you use these metrics to detect symptoms. So you use these metrics to detect that something is wrong and your configuration is not ideal. And then you have some policy that looks at the metrics and decides whether you have to scale out or in. And then you have a scaling action that decides how much you need to scale, right, and where. Okay, that's generally true for all the techniques that have been applied. Now, I don't know, if you were to solve this kind of problem, what kind of mathematical model would you apply? Anything comes to mind? Nothing? Okay. The two most common answers are queuing theory and control theory, right? So queuing theory, because you can model the data flow as a system of queues, and you have tuples coming in, tuples coming out, right? So it's an obvious way. And to do that, you need metrics like service time, waiting time per tuple and per task. And you need how much time is spent processing a tuple and all of its derived tuples. So you need to get per tuple processing and waiting time, but also all the tuples that are a result of every tuple in your input. And you could, at least two of the works I'm aware of, model the, either its operator as a single server queuing system, or they use more generalized, more complex networks. And then this way you can have a scaling action that is actually predictive. It's a closed form equation, and you put the metrics in the equation, and you can scale for all operators. This has several problems for streaming. First of all, because the metrics are too fine-grained and possibly impractical for high-rate streams. So you cannot monitor per tuple service and waiting time in a streaming system that might be processing millions of events per second. It's kind of, And then, so what these existing systems do is they do sampling, but this ends up degrading accuracy. And the problem with the policy is that if you use simple models, the ones that have closed form solutions, these make really strong assumptions. So they make the assumption, for example, that for every input tuple, you know what output tuples were resolved of that tuple, and this works for map, maybe for join and for filter, but it doesn't really work for a custom complex windows. Or it works, you have to really track the provenance of every tuple in the system. So again, it's not practical to do that. They are unsuitable for complex operators. So the second, solution that would come to mind is control theory, right? This whole loop I showed you, it's a feedback control loop, right? So you could consider the input stream and the output stream as input and output signals of your feedback control system, and you need to measure the delay of tuples that have just entered the system, right? That's the metrics you need. And then you can look at the data flow as a black box. You don't care what's happening in there. And existing works use single input, single output models because multi-input, multi-output models actually get too complex to solve. Again, the action is predictive and data flow wide, so that's good. Now, there are several problems with this approach as well. First of all, and I think this is a bit ironic, is that what you want to measure is actually what you want is the output signal is actually the delay time. So you want to measure an output signal that might be arbitrarily delayed because there is some bottleneck in your data flow and you want to measure it, but you don't know how long it will take to measure it. So it's a little bit, it's problematic by definition. There are some workarounds, found workarounds. The second biggest problem is that performance depends a lot on parameter tuning in these systems. So you have to make a lot of experiments on how you are going to place the poles, how to define the sampling period and the damping, because too slow or too large values affect both the accuracy and how long it takes to converge. I think the biggest maybe problem is that exactly because you look at the data flow as a black box, you cannot identify independent bottlenecks. So you don't know which operator is causing the problem. Right? You see, you look at the data flow from the outside. Okay. In fact, the most popular models. I have this again. Sorry, the title is wrong. Here it should say thresholds. Okay, so the most popular, I thought it was a good idea to change some of my slides in the train, and that's a glitch. So, so most of the systems, what they do is they just rely on very simple rule-based policies like they monitor CPU and utilization, memory utilization, and observed metrics from the outside. And they just apply policies of the form if the CPU utilization exceeds 70% and there is a back pressure signal, then you need to scale up. And that works sometimes if you can get very clean metrics. If you're not in a cloud environment where there is interference, if you know how to tune your thresholds that it works for everything, otherwise this kind of policies lead to oscillations and slow convergence. And I'll show you one system that exhibits this behavior. This is Dalion. It's a state-of-the-art scaling controller for Heron. It's Heron is a stream processor used, I think, mainly in Twitter. So here, these are the effects of these controllers scaling to the system. So this is throughput. When you have initially under-provisioned it, and the red line is the throughput you want to meet, right? And just two things I want you to remember here. Six different decisions to reach the output rate, and nearly 2,000 seconds, right? And that's because, well, that's for two reasons. First, because you don't know how much you need to scale, so you try going up a little bit every time. The second are these downtimes here, which are not problem of the policy, but they're problem of the mechanism. Right? When you have to redeploy the new configuration, you have to turn down the system and then start it again. Right? So the 2000 is not because the rule-based policy is slow. It's actually very fast. Okay, I want to give you an idea why this is happening with a very simple example. So say you have a very simple data flow with three operators, a source, operator one, operator two, and you can see from the outside the system, from your normal monitoring infrastructure, that the source is able to produce 40 records per second, but it cannot. It can only produce 10, and that from 101 to 102, you see 100 records per second, right? So these are metrics you can easily get from any stream processor. So if these are the metrics you get from this observed view, you know there is a problem, right? So the signal is there, there's back pressure. But you cannot really tell if it's 01 or 02, which is a bottleneck, right? You know that the source cannot produce, but you don't know if it's which of the two operators cannot keep up, really. And you don't know, so you make a guess, and this is what Dalion does. You make a guess, and you say, let's say it's 01, and then if I want to reach the 40 records, I will add 4 times the resources, and then I will probably reach 40. Even if that is true, you have no idea how this will affect operator 2, right? Is that clear? Yes? Okay, good. So let's see what you can do instead. The idea is simple and similar to the previous one. You add instrumentation to the system, and you get the actual activities of the workers, the actual timelines, in which case you can quite easily say that in this case, at least, O1 is a bottleneck because it's always doing work. And you can also tell that O2 is currently processing 100 records per half a second. So what you get from the observed view is 100 records per second, but the time that O2 is actually doing useful work is only half a second, right? And this is information you can get from the instrumentation. So in this case, you know that if you scale O1 times 2, you need to scale, if you scale O1 4 times, you only need to scale O2 2 times. Yeah? No? Yes? Yes, yes, no? Ask me if you don't get it. You do? Okay, good. It's very simple. Anyway, I have the we can formalize this, but I actually don't want to go through the formulas and stuff. I think the only thing, the important thing to remember here is that we only use the instrumentation, the activities, and the data flow dependencies. So we can collect metrics again in an observation window, like a snapshot we had before, and we get the activity durations, but we also get, in addition to previously, how many records are processed and how many records are pushed to the output per observation window. And through that, we can use then the data flow graph to get the dependencies, right? And then if we know that a worker is a bottleneck and we need to scale it up or down, and we know that other downstream operators depend on this, we can then calculate how much to scale up or down the rest of the operators in the data flow. So the formalization is actually quite straightforward. You represent the data flow as a graph with this, which is with its adjacency matrix, where one means that an operator I is upstream of J, and you assign all operators a sequential increasing ID, and then you use the notion of useful time, which is really what it says. It's the time an operator spends doing useful things. So deserialization, processing, serialization. You could get this by measuring exactly these activities, or you could get it by measuring, by subtracting the weighting from the observation window, whatever is easier for your system. So this actually gives us an ideal view. So if our system was perfectly designed and there were no other bottlenecks, this gives us how much time an operator, so the limit, like how much time an operator, how close it is to not waiting at all, right? And if we use this, the ideal setting, we can then compute the true processing and output rates, which are just records processed or records pushed per unit of useful time, and then you have the aggregate for all the instances. And then you can actually compute, I don't have to explain this, actually it's very easy. You can go, you can have the data flow graph, and you go from the sources to the sinks, computing the ideal parallelism for every operator and the true output rates, and then with just one traversal from left to right, you can compute the ideal parallelisms for all of them, right? So actually, if I just go to the here, I think it's easier, right? So this is exactly this. You have the source, you have O1, and you know its true rate, which is 10/100, and you know that to catch up with the 40, you need to scale this 4 times. And then you go to the next operator in the pipeline, and you know that if you have already the ideal case for this one, which is 4, you haven't applied it yet, but you know if you applied it, what do you need to do with the next operator, right? And this generalizes to arbitrarily complex data flows, right? You just start from the sources, you go one step ahead, and you say, how much parallelism do you need in these states to keep up with the sources? This much. And what would this make to their output rates? What would the ideal case be, right? And then you move on one step at a time, and you get the parallelisms for all the data flow, right? Now, what you get in the end is ideal, right? The ideal rates. What would be the best case ever? The interesting thing about it is that, don't worry about this. Is that in the ideal case, where this is indeed linear, the scaling, this gives you two guarantees. One, that when you scale up, there will be no over-provisioning, because you have already computed the ideal and there's no way you go above that. And the second is that when you scale down, there's no way you create back pressure, there's no way you undershoot, because in this case, it acts as a lower bound. Right? And both these together mean that the policy will actually converge monotonically to the target rate. Okay? Very simple example to show this. So if everything is perfect and doubling the parallelism of an operator actually makes it able to process double the records in the same amount of time, which never happens, I know. But in this case, then you would just predict linear scaling, and then you would go to parallelism one, and that would be your actual scaling. So in one step, you have converged, right? What happens in practice is you usually have sublinear scaling, right? But in this case, you just have this error there, and you make a new prediction, linear again, and then in hopefully limited number of steps, you will converge to the final. So the interesting thing about this is that even though it's so simple, we tried it with different types of operators and different types of systems as well, and in all our experiments, it took up to 3 steps to actually reach that. So no matter if it was a join operator or a window, actually for the very simple ones, for map, filter, and this type of operators, we would just scale in one step. If you had the more complex one with maybe event time or some weird logic, it might take longer, right? of course, there are many like practical things you have to take care of as well. Like if garbage collection kicks in when you're doing this, you will just get like results that make no sense. So you actually need to make sure that the metrics you're getting are the metrics you your model expects, right? So there are some things to keep in mind. Okay. We applied this on Flink here on a timely again. Just a loop. I will show you. Yeah, I just have 3 results, but yeah, this one is the word count I showed you in the beginning with the 6 steps to converge, and the solid lines are DS2, our model, and the dashed lines are the Italian system, the one. I showed you the 6 steps. And what we see here is, this is a word count. So it's just a map and a reduce, map and a count. And it's a very low rate computation, actually. So DS2 converts in 1 step and only 60 seconds. So actually, it just needs to get the metrics from here on once, and then it converges. But I think the most interesting part is that, well, okay, yeah, you see this, the blue line first, then the red line, then the blue line, then the red line. Right? Italian is not able to make a decision for both operators at the same time, exactly because it doesn't know if you scale one operator, what happens to the other. And this is what you see here. Yeah, okay, the timing you saw. But I think the most interesting part is that Dalion not only takes 6 steps, but also over-provisions the system significantly. Like, it decides 10 more counts and 12 more mappers than you actually need to keep up with this computation, which is interesting. Okay. Now, we ran this same experiment on Flink, which can keep up with much higher rates. So instead of 17,000 records per second, we have 2 million records per second to see what happens if you try this in a more like intensive scenario. And we see here, first of all, Flink has a much faster restart mechanism. So it doesn't take 2,000 seconds to do it, but in this case, just 0.5 minute, which still is a lot, but much better than Heron. And the second is, yeah. So in this high rate scenario, we take 2 steps to converge to the when scaling up. And then when scaling down, again, 1 step for the flat map, 2 steps for the count. Okay. So these were word counts, which were very easy, very simple operations. We also tried with the Nexmark benchmark, which is a set of queries, streaming queries with all types of operators. And here, every column is a different query. So flat, not filter, incremental join, tumbling window join, sliding window, session window. A session window is a custom window that has you configure a period that if you don't see any activity in the stream, you assume that the window has closed, right? So it's not a fixed thing. It varies a lot, like how many elements will fall on the window every time. And here we have initial parallelism, so we start from different parallelisms, and then we show the different actions, so the different decisions, right? So you see both scale up and scale down. And it always converges, well, single step for some simple operators and configurations that are actually close to the optimal, and at most three steps in all cases, right? Okay, questions? Yes?
In the streaming processing thing, do you assume in your models that the processing of every item takes the same time?
No.
That doesn't have to be. Can't it vary wildly?
It can vary arbitrarily, and that's why you keep on measuring this. So the true rates that you measure are only valid for the observation window. In the next window, you might get a totally different true rate, and that's fine, because you compute the model continuously. Right? So you do average over the window and over the operator instances. So if you have skew, for example, and you don't have perfectly data parallel operations, this will not solve your skew problem. Right, but you can see this in the instrumentation metric, in the metrics you get from the instrumentation, because you get per operator instance, right? And if these are very different from each other, then you know you have a skew problem, for example. Yeah. Okay. So just to summarize, we use true rates, data flow dependency model to provide predictive data flow wide actions. No oscillations as far as we can tell. The true rates act as bounds, which is interesting, and fast convergence, at least in what we've tried so far. This is also open source and available under the same GitHub repository in stream on system. And and we have recently added one more project under stream on system. That is this one, Megaphone. So, okay, I let's say you have a great scaling controller like the one I showed you, and it can decide how much to scale and really quickly. If you don't have a system that can actually apply this reconfiguration quickly, you're in trouble, right? Because you have these pauses that you're not available when you're applying a reconfiguration, right? So you actually want to be able to do this without downtime. You want to be able to change the parallelism without stopping and restarting your system, which is not a trivial problem, because most of these systems work with checkpointing mechanisms. So if you want to reconfigure, you just have to take a global checkpoint, write your state to disk, and then restart from wherever you left over, and that will take some time. You cannot avoid that, right? So you could also just create a copy of your data flow if you want, but that means double the resources, and that's the problem you're trying to solve here, not over provision. So we've worked on porting a database technique called live migration to streaming, where you progressively migrate state from a running worker to another worker without stopping the computation. So this is an archive paper. It's not published yet, but it's under revision, actually, so it should be published soon. But the code for this is also in the same GitHub repository. And so far, this only works for timely data flow. it's not so straightforward to apply it to something like Flink. But the idea is that you want to figure out which part of a worker state is safe to migrate to another worker, to another parallel worker, without taking a checkpoint and without stopping and restarting the computation. And to avoid the latency spikes that you might have in this case, you break it into small pieces and send it actually together with data of your computation. So you look at the migration as a normal, as a data computation, like any other data flow computation, and you just send the state together with your data. And it looks like it works well. Okay, so another thing we're working on is integrating StreamOn with Faster, which is a key value store from Microsoft Azure that is supposed to be much faster than existing key value stores for state management, like RocksDB. I will tell you how this will turn out. And that's all I had. I actually wanted to tell you everything. Thank you. Yes.
Question from Ewan, who's watching the stream.
Yes.
Especially with the first part you were talking about, he was wondering how your work compares with open tracing, like Jaeger and Zipkin.
Open, I don't know.
So the answer is no.
No.
Yeah, I don't know.
What do these?
I don't know what he's referring to. So.
Okay, I can look them up.
But I have another question.
Yeah.
I was looking at the repository and it looks like most, if not all of it, is done in Rust. Why Rust?
Oh, yeah. Because Rust is amazing. Okay. because many reasons. So StreamOn, the whole streaming system we're building is built on top of timely data flow, which is written in Rust anyway. That's one reason. The scaling controller part is not actually a streaming computation, so we could have written it in any language, but exactly because we have people who have expertise in Rust now, because they have built so many things in Rust, we just use Rust. And actually, yeah, everybody's happy with it. And nobody wants to hear of Java or JVM things in the systems group, so we had to choose something like Rust or C. Like jokes aside, Rust has worked really well for what we do. It's really fast. It does protect you from several mistakes you make in other languages. And in fact, it's not that difficult for students to pick up, as we thought initially. So we tell all the master students or bachelor students that come to work with us that there is this exotic language that you will have to work with if you come here, and in a couple of weeks they all do fine. So
any more questions?
Well, thank you.
Thank you.